welcome again to another Sounds Interesting summer special featuring one band and their music. And tonight it's a band whose music is more widely known by other musicians and music journalists than by the broader rock audience. A band whose music reflects influences from avant-garde jazz to avant-garde conservatoire and taking in rock, 1930s German cabaret style and many other precedents along the way. And they are virtually the most political band around. Their commitment to Marxism has produced music with a strong polemical streak. Henry Cow is their enigmatic name, and after a first burst of music from them, Chris Cutler, their drummer, will be talking with me. This was the sound of Henry Cow on their first complete album 2 years ago.
Thank you.
out of Teen Beat, that was, from the first Henry Cow album, Legend, when the band was a quintet. Chris Cutler, that was made not long after you joined the band, and the band's personnel has changed a bit since that early disc. What effects have these changes had on the band's music, do you think?
In as much as the music that the group makes is a product of the people in the group, considerable. In the course of the development of this group, everybody's style has changed. The way that we work is very collective, and it means that one or other member of the group is always pacemaking, and the others catch up. And the composing is always ahead of our ability to perform, which makes us all improve. And our improvised music makes it possible to compose new forms of music that no one had considered possible.
What would you say was the predominant influence on the people in the band?
In the long run, I'd say probably rock music. When I joined the group, however, it was jazz rock that was being played. But other parts are mostly rock, and I think we consider ourselves as being basically a rock group.
Yeah. If it's rock, though, your music is certainly more complex and thought-provoking, too, I think, than most rock groups. Now, does your audience have to be at a similar level of, as it were, musical sophistication to enjoy your music fully?
No, I think they need 2 ears, really. Mm-hmm. That's enough. We've played to audiences with very little musical sophistication. We did some concerts recently in the south of Italy, and because nobody knew that our music was supposed to be difficult or intellectual, they had no problem with it.
One thing that strikes me about the band is the way that you play very short pieces offset against long and involved compositions. So let's have an example of that from your second album, Unrest. Arcades and then straight into Deluge. Thank you. Chris, that second piece invites the immediate question, I think. How much of your music is scored or arranged, and how much is improvised?
We work in three ways. There are pieces which are wholly composed, that is, every note, more or less, is composed and placed. We improvise constructively, but nevertheless without any prior idea of form, and leave it at that. And this last piece...
Deluge.
Deluge. is a result of working in the studio, using the studio as an instrument, 16-track tape as an instrument. It's based on an improvisation which was made into a tape loop which was then recorded over with various other parts. So you don't hear the loop, but you hear a continuous rhythm.
Yeah, sure.
Was then superimposed over the second half so that the two melodies slowly change places.
Mm-hmm.
A half-tempo version of the last tune on Ruin from the first side of the same record,
mm-hmm.
culminating in this song and the extraneous noise in the orchestra tuning up. So this, the whole thing was made into a piece of written music from a material that existed already on the record, which we slowed down and then added a lot of parts to, and writing over the top of an improvisation which was extended.
Mm-hmm. And what about that writing? Because I see both these pieces are credited to Henry Cow. How do you actually compose as a group of people, bearing in mind all those complexities which you just mentioned?
It's empirical. Pieces that are credited to Henry Cow generally are pieces which have been created in the studio, which means that we start with an improvisation, or rather a series of improvisations from which we select and edit, and then start to shape, the way a sculptor moulds clay, a piece, a structured piece of music from it, which we do collectively. We discuss what we're going to do, we try things out.
Mm-hmm.
So no one can really be said to have written
a piece. Yeah. The thing too that about this last piece we've just heard is that on that whole album there is a statement on the sleeve where you say all the sounds were made with the instruments listed above.
I think we were probably fairly proud of the fact that we'd made all those sounds without using any real trickery. And we wanted people to know. And also to show that it could be done.
Yeah.
Well, there's still a lot of room for expansion with the instruments that we have. I don't think we need to go into electronics just yet. And I do think that there's a certain amount to be gained from limiting your palate, as it were.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is a form of discipline, which is valuable.
Well, that album, you were still mostly into instrumental effects, but by the time of the next album with which you were associated, there was a lot more emphasis, it seems to me, on words. Indeed, you'd got together by then with Slap Happy, a German band, and using the very distinctive high voice of Dagmar, a singer from Hamburg. I detected, too, in the record that you made with Slap Happy, Desperate Straits, that your work was beginning to come more political. Now, was it the German influence of Slap Happy, and I'm thinking especially of that Kurt Weill, Lottie Lenier, Germanic cabaret bit of the 1930s, which began to turn you much more on politically?
No. We were going to do an album of songs as our next album before we met Slap Happy and before we decided to do this album with them. Most of the lyric content on that record, Peter Blegvan is responsible for. He is not an overtly political figure. He's involved with Blake and Rambo, and there's always not an edge of cynicism, but an edge of despair in his work. And Desperate Straits is, in fact, a chronicle of desperate straits,
yeah.
And the various grimnesses that kill their lives. And it's only political in as much as it sympathises with the outcasts.
Right. Before we look at the political stance of your work a bit more deeply and talk also about the concept ideas behind your various albums, perhaps we ought to listen to some of the results of your collaboration with Slap Happy, including arrangement of a fragment from Handel's Messiah. Whatever before we hear it made you do that?
Well, when Mozart edited the Messiah, he cut this bit out,
yeah.
And Peter thought that it ought to be given a fair hearing.
Mm-hmm. Just like that. Okay. The music then. First Messiah and then In the Sick Bay.
He gave his back to the smiters. He gave his back to the smiters. And his to them that lacketh of the head, and his cheek to them that lacketh of the head. them that black head of my head. He did not take from shame and sitting. He did not take from shame, from shame and sitting.
Desperate Straits was the title of that Henry Cow Slap Happy album. Now, you got together with the band, then almost immediately after getting together, you broke up, except that you kept hold of Dagmar from Slap Happy. Was there any story behind that?
First question is why we decided to join together. In the making of Desperate Straits, which I think was a wonderful experience for us and for Slap Happy, we discovered each a part that the other had not got. For instance, we were able to do songs, we were able to play a style of music that we ourselves, at that time, couldn't have written, couldn't have played. And they, for their part, were able to step out temporarily of their philosophical connections with trash culture. But after making this record, we were all very euphoric, and we thought it would be a good idea for us to try and make the group that made that record into a permanent group that could perform, because the two opposites are so extreme that the marriage would have been wonderful.
Well, it didn't work.
No,
well, you've not done badly, have you? Because if we move on to your very latest record, In Praise of Learning, you've got Dagmar, and you've got quite a few other people who were a bit associated with that Slap Happy Henry Cow record also working on it. And I suppose it is, In Praise of Learning, about the most overtly political record you've made. And I love this bit on the sleeve, which carries a quote from John Grierson, the documentary filmmaker, I take that to be, which says, "Art is not a mirror, it is a hammer." Now, what exactly do you mean by that?
Well, the mirror and the lamp. Functions that are credited to art are that of reflecting the world, and that of maybe changing, of maybe defining a different way of observing things, which should be more constructive and more helpful. Up to the present, there's been a lot of reflecting, a lot of saying how bad things are, a lot of laying bare the inadequacies of society that we live in. But there's not been much doing about it. But as Grierson said, art can be a hammer. That is to say, it can be a weapon. It can be a way of changing things. It can be a tool in the hands of people. I would say that our records, I would prefer to be seen as part of a continuing work. So they should be viewed in sequence as part of one work.
Mm-hmm.
Each record, possibly the exception of Leg End, when we were not very conscious of this process ourselves,
mm-hmm.
does concentrate on a particular area. Unrest is very much to do with unrest, to do with, in fact, art being a mirror, reflecting the state of the world and the state of ourselves as it was at that time. Desperate Straits carries that further, but introduces more compassion and more hope. And in Praise of Learning, which again is not to be considered as a whole statement, but as part of this continuing statement, takes the hammer aspect mm-hmm. instead of the mirror aspect and develops that.
I would like to rewrite Grierson and say art is not necessarily either a mirror or a hammer.
And I agree with you, I mean, art is not in fact either a mirror or a hammer. It's just that we concentrate on one thing at a time in order to make each thing clear
mm-hmm.
and then progress.
Now that's clear and that's fair.
But one must avoid a confusion between propaganda and art. If we were doing political work, we'd be writing propagandist songs like Joe Hill and perhaps Brecht later.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not. We're dealing with language itself. We're dealing, if you like, with the theoretical side of things. And therefore, although there will be overt politics, I'm sure, on all of the records, we're not doing propaganda work as an end in itself.
Did the band form itself for political ends, or have they kind of evolved out of the association of the members of the band?
They evolved, definitely, over a long period, too. And in fact, they've surfaced on this record. When it's appeared to us that it's finally possible for us to express certain things that were not really possible to express before, basically because Dagmar is a singer, we can use lyric content. The expression of it on this record is overt in the four verses of Kim's song at the end. But I think you'll find the other lyrics on this record are concerned more with language and expression than with simply saying, get on with it. But we are committed to certain political ideals, and because we are also artists, and artists serve the whole man, then what we do has got to express, directly or indirectly, what we feel about society and the fact that we feel that it has to be changed and that change is going to only come from people getting involved, from people learning about the world that they're in. Praise of Learning means that the first thing is to inform oneself. And then having informed oneself, in other words, having gained the power through knowledge of the world, then to follow those tendencies which are progressive, which will lead out of this mess. And we're working in the field of art, in the field of music specifically, and now lyrics. And consequently the work is fairly oblique. It is necessary with this record and with this music to actually become involved in it. Because it lives, because it's unfinished, because there are relations which one only notices fourth, fifth, tenth listening, and because they do all relate in a deliberate and conscious way, after a time, if you work at it, a pattern begins to emerge, and a habit of examining things, of analysing things, begins to form.
Can I ask you one last question? I've never seen an explanation for the name Henry Cow. Will you please give us one?
Well, no.
Why do you always make such a mystery of it?
Marcel Duchamp these five mothers worked with Rose Salavi, which is a female name. Then he carried the compound masculine and feminine name.
You're putting us on. I think we will finish with some music. And what better to finish with than In Praise of Learning, which we've just been talking about. This is the last half of Living in the Heart of the Beast, the longest piece on the album. And we pick it up after Dagmar has sung several verses about the chaos and confusion of the world and is moving towards a demand for so-called fight for freedom. First, though, there's a fine instrumental bridge. Playing from were Legend, Unrest, In Praise of Learning, and Desperate Straits, which Henry Carr made with Slap Happy. All are on the Virgin label. That's all for the present, but I hope you'll be with us next Sunday for a look at the work of 10cc. Until then, I thank you as always most warmly for listening, and I bid you a peaceful good night.